Second time this has failed on me on the first inspection. Let's try something different. Much better. A few years ago, I thought to myself, it's the 21st century. Why can't I just press a button and get smoke? I don't get it. Sorry. I shouldn't have done this inside. I started the way anybody would start this. I looked on Amazon and said, well, what else creates smoke? And I found these meat smokers, which was really interesting. The first one that I started with was this very simple meat smoker. I'll show you how it works. I started out with this meat smoker. It's made to smoke meats like steak that you put into a little chamber. There's a little area here for putting wood chips into, things like this apple wood chip. It's very simple to use. You just take a little bit of this wood chip and put it in here, and you turn on the fan and you use a flame to light it. And out comes the smoke. You can even turn it off for a minute or two, put it down, and then turn it back on again. And as long as the flame doesn't go out, it keeps running. This is extremely crude, but it's what I imagined in my mind when I saw the meat smoker. I wonder if I could create a one-button press device where by pressing one button, turns on the fan, and at the same time, it ignites the fuel. The problem here is it's not a huge volume of smoke. You have to be very focused with this. It obviously doesn't run for a very long time. I'm going to estimate somewhere between 30 and 40 seconds being functional. I will tell you, this is super hot right now to the touch, not the way I wanted to go. I researched a bit more and I found this other smoker that was really, really promising. I really love the design of being handheld. It feels good in the hand. Little short for a hand like mine because I'm a taller guy with a bigger hand. You put a little bit of material, organic material into here. You could use the wood chips that I had talked about before. I use burlap because burlap has an extreme amount of smoke. That's kind of a known thing in the beekeeping industry. I only had to do one modification to it. So you see, this is kind of short. And so I cut this off of here. I wanted to have a very short nozzle. The reason these nozzles are normally long is that you would put this under a glass dish. That way you could just set this up on the side, be able to smoke the dish like so. I wanted this to be a compact little gun, and it worked beautifully for that. I actually used this for an entire year. It worked wonderfully. The one thing that I will say is you have to reload it fairly consistently. I would say every time that you're working in another box, you basically have to replace the fuel for it. Word of warning, if you do try this out, this obviously gets very, very hot. So you're not going to want to mount this onto something and put it on your bee suit, put it on your belt clip, because it will get super hot. With my device, it never gets hot to the touch. The nozzle stays cold, so then I can mount it onto anything I want. Just to give you an idea of how long this lasts, let's go ahead and time it. Now, obviously, when I'd be using this, I'd be turning it on and off in the bee yard, so it would last a lot longer than this. It's still going at 2 minutes, but I would say that it's not adequate smoke. I started with all kinds of crazy designs with this. Thought about making it like a six shooter where you create a pistol so you don't have to reload it very often. Like a cap gun where caps come through and get smoke. I also thought about a Keurig style where you'd be able to put a pod in here in order to burn just the pod and be able to dispose of the pod after you're done. Came up with all different types of weird ideas. It was around the time of the COVID pandemic that I started to get really frustrated with this. I actually took some time off on it. Still kept coming back down to we're dealing with fire here and it really doesn't feel very safe. Am I just reinventing another smoker? It has a lot of the same problems. Then one day I was driving down the street and I saw a young man in his car and he was vaping up a storm. It almost looked like a dragon was inside of this thing. You couldn't even see outside. It was like Cheech and Chong. You couldn't see outside the windshield. And I thought to myself, boy, you know, rather than just grabbing a bunch of sticks and twigs and things like that, perhaps even that have pesticides in them out of the field and putting them into a smoker, I could control very meticulously the types of oils that are being put in there to be able to not only calm the bees, but also to be able to do things like varroa treatment potentially, or treatments for small hive beetle, just overall help out with the health of the bees. I looked for the most powerful handheld device that pushes air. There's a lot of vacuums out there, but the air duster really worked out well. Started to experiment with vaporization with regular coils and then also with something called sub-ohm coils, which creates a ton of vapor very effectively. And then trying it with the air duster that I mentioned earlier. It took a lot of learning and experimentation. This was an embryonic stage, and I won't say that it was promising at all, but I did find that it was possible to do, and it moved me to my next phase. I bought a bunch of vaporizers, vape machines even, pushed smoke through the device. I tried it on the bees, but I wasn't able to get the amount of volume of smoke that I needed. And so I took Ziploc bags, kind of stupid, but I ended up putting into it a bunch of smoke just to be able to have a big store of smoke in order to be able to puff it on the bees, so that I would be able to see what the effect was. And it actually worked. I was frustrated by the lack of smoke. I'm ashamed to say this. I ended up grabbing my brother's fog machine from Halloween, and I ended up putting into it the fog juice. I swear to God, I looked like a complete maniac. If my neighbors would have seen me, they would have reported me to the police. I was out there shooting the bees. It created the biggest plume of smoke that I've seen. And when the smoke cleared, do you know what happened? Absolutely nothing. The bees just looked up at me like, what's going on, dude? I can't tell you how frustrated I was. It was really a very low point. I was frustrated because this volume of smoke was overkill. And if this volume of smoke didn't make the bees react, then what would? I started to realize there's different aspects of smoke, not just the visual component, but also the smell of smoke and also the heat of smoke. And so I started to think to myself, I bet that that has a lot more to do with it than the visual aspect of smoke. From a smoke perspective, this device does the visual aspect of smoke like spades. However, it doesn't smell like smoke. There's not a whole lot of heat. And so I started to think to myself, well, I need to start separating out these components and start testing them out individually. I could probably do an entire video just on how I've been experimenting with different oils in order to produce a smell that would affect the bees. And long story short, I've been finding that a lot of the smokes that have that sort of smoky smell to them actually work pretty well. There are lots of products that have come and gone, some that are even still on the market, that are sort of a smokeless variety where you just spray it on the bees. They oftentimes have like floral smells. Certain floral smells are known to not only disrupt the alarm pheromone that guard bees have, but also to generally distract the bees due to the smell. There's an old saying that if your first prototypes don't embarrass you, then you're not moving fast enough. And this definitely is a very embarrassing device. This is just a vaporization device that's attached to an air duster and has a reservoir here to be able to pull it into there. It's still a two-button press system, so it's not super convenient, but it gave me that feeling of being able to work with the bees. I learned very quickly with this that rather than pulling the smoke through the fan and getting the fan gunked up with smoke, the best way to do it is to push the smoke from the back. This is my next evolution. So you can see I've attached the vape onto the side of this, and it's still a two-button press system, but it is running off of one battery now, and it has this machined part here. And the machined part has the coil in it. The oils can go into the screwed-in area. Not a super convenient form factor, but you can see the evolution. A couple of things that I learned from doing this prototype. One was that I wanted to be able to replace the fuel source very easily. One of the other things that I found was that the air duster was a little too powerful for the bees, so it would blow them around a little too much. I decided to go with being able to regulate the speed in order to be able to have like a windy day, you have a little bit more power. On a less windy day, you can dial it down and be able to smoke less. These were my next prototypes, and this is where I started to put on the side the discs in order to be able to attach it to a magnet. It's attachable, it's ugly. Obviously, you need to make sure that these holes are small enough that it doesn't become a bee blender where the bee gets in here and then bsh. I thought to myself, what is the most comfortable tool that I use on a day-to-day basis? And I thought it's my DeWalt drill. And so I fashioned this shape based on that. You can see the difference in how clunky this design is versus this design. It absolutely had a different feel to it at that point. This one is my V5.1 and it's mostly got a display. It's got increased volume. So I've got a little display here. I'm not sure if you can see that okay. It tells you different types of information like how much more battery power there is. It comes up with a cute display that says technically beekeeping, that type of thing. And then I've got an up and down button that controls the fan speed. And all you have to do is press the button in order to get the smoke. I've got it where you have to press it twice in order to get the smoke the first time. That way it's a debounce switch. Batteries are removable. I also have the ability to charge this. And so my plan is to use USB-C for that. A lot of popular tools like this oxalic acid vaporizer uses DeWalt batteries. Made me wonder, what if I used a drill battery like so? A lot of beekeepers already have chargers for these, and it might make for a very nice device. Let me know what you think about this in the comments below. I really appreciate your feedback. You might be wondering what the circle is for. So the circle is for being able to put it onto a belt clip so you can work with a beehive and know where it is at all times. This is something you probably don't want to leave out in the field. So if you're working on your bees, you can just grab it and smoke your bees and put it back on. It would also be something that I could take this piece and put it onto like a bee suit somewhere. It doesn't have to be a belt clip like this one is, but the way that the belt clip works is it kind of mates with this nicely so that it just snaps in place. A couple of Vib insiders suggested that I put the mount directly onto the hive, which I love that idea. From a practical perspective, I'd probably put it here on the deep since this one doesn't move very often, but it gives you the idea. You may also be wondering why these two are different. This piece above is just an optional piece that I'm working on. I call it a smart device. It has a camera and then a power switch, and then you can charge it separately. It has its own battery. And the idea is to make this a smart inspection device. When I press the button, it will trigger this and make this activate. I can record things as soon as I'm smoking or before I'm smoking, or I could even potentially add another switch here somewhere, maybe a thumb switch or something, where I would press the thumb switch and it would take a video or it would take a picture. The idea here is to automate the activity and record information about inspecting your bees. It also would have Bluetooth, be able to talk with a cell phone or some other device and be able to push those images somewhere. That's what I'm thinking that the future of the bee smoker could be, is to be able to add these types of devices and be able to inspect your bees. It would become more than a smoker. It would be a smart inspection device and a smoker at the same time. My next prototype, I'm also thinking about putting a QR code on here. And the idea is in this magnetized area to be able to scan it with a phone and be able to get instructions on how to use it, maybe how to inspect your bees. Let me know what you think in the comments below. What would you use it for? The next version of this is going to be more like a drill, where I'm going to add some components to it to make it more solid. Obviously, this is just a prototype, so if it fell on the ground, it would shatter into pieces. It's just 3D printed plastics. So I'm a second generation beekeeper. I remember as a kid, my dad would light the smoker for me and my friend that would go out and help out with the bees. And whenever it would go out, he would have to come in and light it with a cigarette lighter, you know, even sometimes a cigarette, and help us to get it started again. And I just thought to myself too that, you know, if you're working with children, this kind of a product would be much safer. Their fingers aren't going to get burnt by the sides of it. They're also not going to have issues with getting it started, keeping it lit. And the vapor needs to be safe for humans and bees. For those of you that are a wizard at getting a smoker started and keeping it going, I think that's fantastic. This doesn't necessarily have to replace every single use of it. I think that it's similar to a horse and a car. If I'm going to drive into work, I'm going to be using the car. I'm not going to be using the horse. I think similarly, if I'm going to relax on a weekend, maybe I ride the horse. I think that it's not necessarily one or the other. Beeks, like I say in the title, I'm obsessed with creating the future of a bee smoker. I think that we've been using this thing that's been designed in the 1800s, and I think it's time to move to newer technology. I honestly do. I have a link down below if you're interested in helping out with this. We have an insider club that is fantastic. Sign up and help me out with trying to develop the future of a bee smoker. Speaking of the very important Beekeeper Club, if you haven't seen my video on the jar feeder and how we're 100xing it using science and technology, check it out here.